آمنوا كونوا قوامين بالقسط شهداء لله شهداء لله ولا على أنفسكم أو الوالدين والأقربين إن يكن غنيا أو فقيرا فالله أولى بهما فلا تتبعوا الهوى أن تعدلوا وإن تلووا أو تعرضوا فإن الله كان بما تعملون خبيرا يا أيها الذين آمنوا كونوا قوامين لله شهداء بالقسط ولا يجرمنكم شنآن قوم على ألا تعدلوا اعدلوا هو أقرب للتقوى واتقوا الله إن الله خبير بما تعملون ولا تستوي الحسنة ولا السيئة ادفع بالتي هي أحسن فإذا الذي بينك وبينه عداوة كأنه ولي حميم وما يلقاها إلا الذين صبروا وما يلقاها إلا ذو حظ عظيم.
The translation, inshallah. O you who have attained to faith, be ever steadfast in upholding equity, bearing witness to the truth for the sake of God, even though it be against your own selves or parents or kinfolk. Whether the person concerned be rich or poor, God's claim take precedence over the claims of either of them. Do not then follow your own desires, lest you swerve from justice. For if you distort the truth or refuse to testify, behold, God is indeed aware of all that you do. O you who believe, stand out firmly for Allah as witnesses to fair dealings, and let not the hatred of others to you make you swerve to wrong and depart from justice. Be just. That is next to piety. And fear Allah, for Allah is well acquainted with all that you do. But since good and evil cannot be equal, repel thou evil with something that is better. Lo, he between whom and thyself was enmity may then become as though he had always been close unto thee. And true friend, ye to achieve, this is not given to any but those who are wont to be patient and adversary in adversity. It is not given to any but those endowed with great good fortune. Sadaqallahu al-Azim. Surely Allah speaks the truth. Thank you for your attention. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
JazakAllah khair. I'd like to take a moment to thank all our sponsors. Each of you should have a booklet on your table. Please take your booklet home. Support the sponsors like you supported here at CAIR. They mean a lot to the organization, and the organization means a lot to them. So if you support CAIR, please support the sponsors. You know, being up here as MC, I wasn't even sure how I was going to start the night off. Most of the time when I'm at events, I actually do comedy, not necessarily emceeing. One time my friend asked me about a year ago, asked me, Ali, can you come and speak at my wedding? And I said, I don't really do weddings. The reason I don't do weddings is because it's exactly kind of like what's happening now. People are eating. They're looking behind them. Is some guy talking? Okay, anyways, I'll continue eating. So it's really hard to talk to people when they're not looking at you, and it's in circular tables, et cetera, et cetera. But I said, you know what? You're my friend for 15 years. You never asked me for one favor. I'll do this for you. And the reason he asked me to do it, he said, Ali, if you come to my wedding, this is the situation. My dad's a doctor. I'm a doctor, my wife is a doctor, most of the people at my wedding are doctors. So it's not gonna be like an exciting wedding, it's gonna be like a medical wedding. So it's gonna be like everyone talking about medicine, and we just want to put some excitement in there. I'm like, okay. So I said, what do you want me to say? He said, just be yourself. I said, okay, sure. So right before I was about to go on stage, his father was speaking, and I guess he was the next person he was the person before me, and what he'd said is, before the next person comes up, which was me, I'd like to thank Dr. So-and-so for coming tonight. And that doctor would stand up and everyone would clap for him. And I have to thank the Dr. So-and-so for coming, and he would stand up. And the pediatrician, thank you. Neurosurgeon, thank you. Brain surgeon, thank you. And this went on for a very, very long time. It got to the point that I'm looking around and I'm realizing I think I'm the only non-doctor here. So right there it hit me. I said, I know what I'm going to say when I'm going to get up stage. I had something funny to say, actually. So I got up on stage, and I was like this. With all the doctors that are here tonight, who's at the hospital? They didn't laugh. They're all looking at each other. Who is at the hospital? It was a disaster from that point all the way to the end of my talk. I think they should introduce me as a comedian next time. Okay. So this is much better because you guys are actually smiling when I'm speaking, so this is really cool. And you guys are not all doctors, right? Okay, fantastic. Okay. Our next speaker, our first speaker. This is our first speaker. Actually, I'm not really a speaker, I'm the MC. Our first speaker is actually the CEO of AmeriHealth Mercy Family and of Companies. He's won numerous awards. He's been honored with these awards. Last year, 2012, Urban League of Philadelphia Power of Diversity Leadership Award, he won that. YMCA John Wanamaker Corporate Award, he won that. The Philadelphia Tribune labeled him as, gave him the award actually, as one of the most, Philadelphia's most influential leaders. This man is going to be giving you guys a nice talk, inshallah. Hopefully, inshallah, you guys will be giving him the same attention you gave me. If he says something funny, please laugh. If he doesn't say something, please laugh. I'm just joking. Okay, but inshallah, next speaker up, will please welcome Michael A. Rashid, please.
Good evening, everyone. Oh, what a beautiful audience this is. I mean, we have all colors, all nationalities. The sisters are dressed beautifully. Thank you so much for coming to the 7th annual CAIR Banquet. You know, for almost 30 years, since 1994, the Council of American Islamic Relations has been working with Muslims, non-Muslims, employees and employers to educate them in terms of their rights under the American Constitution, the obligations that we have to respect people's rights, and helping people in the process to understand human dignity and what we really mean by freedom of religion in this great country of the United States of America. As an employer, my company that employs over 3,000 people operating in 13 states, we welcome and we honor and respect the work that CAIR does all over this country. Our supervisors appreciate the fact that CAIR is able to work with us to educate them about Islam and also to help our employees feel comfortable in the workplace so they can do their best work. So I just want to, first of all, welcome you to this great event, tell you how much I appreciate the CAIR board and all the folks at CAIR who put on this great event, but even more importantly, the work that CAIR does in the United States, but especially in the Philadelphia area. I encourage you not just to support this event, but to support CAIR. This is the major effort that CARE has throughout the year to supplement its budget. So thank you for buying a dinner, but I want to encourage everyone, and I encourage myself, to get more involved with CARE and to support the great work that they are doing. There's no time that we need this work more than today. So thank you so much for coming out. Hope you have a great evening.
Thank you for your encouraging words. Next up, we're going to do something very unique, very different. We're going to invite three people here on stage, and these people are part of CARE's Philadelphia staff. And we're going to do a conversational piece here. And we're going to talk about some important issues. Let me introduce the three people. First person that will be on stage with us will be CARE Philadelphia Civil Rights Director, Attorney Amari Chowdhury. The person next to her, as the person setting up the chairs right now for us. The next person next to her will be the Outreach Director, and I apologize if I am butchering your name. I will do the best I can. Rujiatu Chowdhury. No, not Chowdhury. Conte. I am not a butcher, but if I was a butcher, that would be a halal butchering for those who are worried about if those would be her or not. And the last person is Executive Committee Outreach Member, Attorney Fatima Abbas. Please come on stage and so we can hear your enlightening words. Please come soon. Thank you.
Assalamu alaikum. Oops, that's way too close. Assalamu alaikum, everyone. As Baba Ali just mentioned, this is going to be kind of in a different format. It's not going to be the typical speech. I'm going to be asking questions to Rugi and Amar kind of about the work that CARE's done in the past year, and it's going to be in a conversational format. Assalamu alaikum, Rugi and Amar. How are you?
Salam.
So before we get into the specific accomplishments of CARE in 2012, I wanted to get at why CARE is important. Why, as just an organization, does it matter to the Muslim community?
Okay, thank you, Fatima. But I just wanted to make a correction on my name. My name is Rugiatu Konta. That was a nice try, Baba Ali.
But that's a really good good question.
CARE is very important because it serves as the public voice of American Muslims. So I really want to put that out there. We consider ourselves a public voice of Muslims. We try to make sure that we empower the community, that we encourage civic engagement, and that we also protect the civil liberties of American Muslims. And I think, Amari, you can talk more about that.
So I actually want to start out by mentioning that the Muslim community is not alone in having an advocacy organization. Many communities have worked on the same model. In the Philadelphia area alone, we know that since 1881, there's been an organization known officially as the Hebrew Immigrant Aid Society, otherwise known as HIAS. We do a great deal of work with them. They've been around for over 100 years. In Upper Darby, here in Delaware County, there's been an organization since 1988 known as the Irish Immigration Center. Now, probably everyone in the room is familiar with an organization known as the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, better known as the NCAACP. Now, let's think about the role that these organizations play in society. We know that in America, 60 years ago, separate but equal was the law of the land. Now, what happened to change that? We know that in 1954, there was a landmark Supreme Court case that officially struck down legally mandated segregation, but that case did not happen in a vacuum. We know that several things happened. Martin Luther King Jr. led a march on Washington. There were boycotts of segregated businesses. There were sit-ins at lunch counters. you know, there is a book actually called The Race Beat, Pulitzer Prize winner from 2006, that documents the role of the media. So all of these things work together to do no more or no less than to change America as we know it. That is the role that CAIR plays in today's society.
And do you see CAIR as an organization that attempts to use an assorted approach to civil rights? And by assorted, I mean a mixture of media work, legal advocacy, and community empowerment, similar to the NAACP?
I do. That's why I mentioned them.
And can you speak about some of the specific legal cases that you've worked on in 2012 with CAIR?
Sure. So actually, my biggest cases at CAIR-Philadelphia have been against government agencies. So, for example, I recently filed a lawsuit against the FBI and the United States Customs and Immigration Services in federal court in Philadelphia. But we don't have time to talk about all of my cases, so I'm going to focus on one which we actually completed successfully, and that was against the United States Department of Defense. So we represented a gentleman who was a federal employee who had lost his security clearance and as a result thereof wasn't able to obtain promotions in the regular course and therefore was denied salary and benefits and the right to retire at a certain job grade. Now, this wouldn't surprise people to know that the federal government has certain rules when it pertains to people who have jobs where they would have access to sensitive information. If people do have access to sensitive governmental information, they cannot be individuals who would then be susceptible to divulge that information to people who wish America harm, right? I mean, that's a rule that makes sense. It keeps all of us in this room much more safe. We don't have a problem with the rule itself. The question is whether there is discriminatory enforcement and whether they're just kind of automatically assuming that if someone has a Muslim name or they learn is Muslim, is automatically susceptible to divulge those secrets. So we had that case. I actually went down to Arlington, Virginia with the big bad legal team of me, myself, and I, and we had a day-long trial in Arlington, and we succeeded in getting that gentleman his security clearance back.
That's great. Did CAIR attempt... Before you took on this case on your own, on behalf of CAIR, of course, did you attempt to partner with any other organizations, any organizations that specifically litigate security clearance type of cases?
We did. So when the gentleman came to us, he actually mentioned that he didn't want to partner with a private firm. Now, for those of you who aren't aware, most civil rights organizations in the United States do not take cases on by themselves. They frequently partner with other law firms in every major case. We did reach out to another more general civil rights organization and ask their assistance to co-counsel, but in the end, if I had someone offered a co-counsel, I would have taken them up on that offer. But the truth is that client would not have had legal representation if we did not get involved. And truthfully, he had been denied his security clearance many years ago. As soon as we became involved, we got a trial in front of an administrative judge within a matter of months.
So would you basically see CAIR's work in that instance as taking on a case that many saw as unwinnable?
I do. I mean, someone had actually told me these cases are very difficult to win. We don't partner in these kinds of cases. Well, they are difficult to win, but thankfully we took it, and praise be to God, we did win the case.
Awesome.
Thank you.
So in addition to the Department of Defense case, mm-hmm. another case that I'm sure a lot of people, not necessarily a case, but a legal issue that a lot of people in this room have probably heard of is the anti-Sharia bill that certain people in Pennsylvania attempted to pass. Can you explain CAIR's role in opposing that bill?
Sure, but I'm actually going to start by correcting you on the name, because people have referred to it as an anti-Sharia bill. And the implication there is that the bill is designed to target a particular body of law, Islamic law, otherwise known as Sharia. Well, I've got to tell you, Pennsylvania was not alone in introducing this kind of bill. States in more than half the country have now considered such legislation, and I will tell you, I don't call them anti-Sharia bills. And as a matter of fact, when I write that, I put anti-Sharia in quotes. I call them anti-Muslim bills. These bills were not designed to target a body of law. They were not designed to target a set of religious principles or beliefs. They were designed to demonize and to villainize a group of Americans, to declare us, as a matter of legislative record, as being less worthy of being American. And that is why we took that issue on. Got it.
And did you partner with other groups in that effort?
We did actually have some help in that effort. As a matter of fact, I have guests here today from the Philadelphia Bar Association who did pass a resolution in opposition to the bill. The City of Philadelphia City Council passed a resolution in opposition to that bill, and Pittsburgh City Council passed a resolution in opposition to that bill. I believe Ruthie will chime in a moment to talk about the interfaith effort that she led to also oppose the bill. So to a certain extent, we actually did have some assistance. Ruthie, do you want to elaborate?
Okay, so we had support from the Interfaith Peace Walk, who also joined us in our press conference. It was December of last year. So they were very instrumental in supporting us in opposing that bill.
And also Rabbi Linda Holzman of Mishkan Shalom in Philadelphia came out to the press conference and supported us. So we did partner with people. We did have their support. But I want to go back to my original statement that this is not about a body of law. It's about demonizing a group of people because, you know, we had all the support. But then at some point in time when there were no voting days left in the General Assembly, one of the bill's sponsors sought to have a public hearing on the bill. Now, let's think about it. If there are no voting days left, what was he trying to do at the public hearing? I just told you. He set out to try to demonize and to villainize American Muslims. And, you know, at that point in time, you know, people who thought that the fight was about opposing a piece of legislation didn't get it. They didn't join us in that fight. However, because we realized that the bill was actually about demonizing some people, we did actually have some organizations working behind the scenes with us to make sure that those public hearings were quashed.
That's great. Thank you to everybody in the room who participated in opposing that bill. And lastly, Amar, in addition to the Department of Defense case, the anti-Sharia bill, has there been any other large cases that you feel CAIR has taken a prominent role in?
I mean, we do have big cases. I just mentioned to you that just the other day I sued the FBI, and that's what some people would consider a big case. But, you know, not every case is against, you know, the Department of Defense, the FBI, like these big, takes me like 1,000 man hours to litigate. We had a smaller case that should be mentioned, and that's actually, it involved the Pennsylvania Department of Corrections, and there was one particular facility that when Muslim men entered who wore a kufi, they were denied visitation rights. They weren't told, come here, let's search underneath your kufi, then you can go forward. So one gentleman contacted us. He said, look, I'm trying to visit my friends, show moral support, and my friends are incarcerated. What can I do? We looked at the visitation dress policy, and we realized that there were actually a lot of accommodations made for Muslim women who wore the niqab. So we knew the warden's heart was in the right place. So we reached out to him by letter, so not a lawsuit, by letter. And he said, wow, you're right. I didn't realize there was this loophole here. And so I sent him the letter on a Thursday. He called me on a Friday when he got it, and by Monday he had changed the visitor dress code policy to the benefit of all religious persons or persons who wish to wear religious garb, indicating that they would be permitted to visit their friends, family, whomsoever, as long as they dressed appropriately. So that's an example of not a case, but you can catch more bees with honey than vinegar type advocacy.
It's kind of the ideal solution.
Yeah.
Moving on from actual cases, I'm sure a lot of you have heard about bullying in the Muslim community, in the general American community at large. CAIR's taken on bullying with a variety of campaign initiatives, and I wanted to get into that with Rugi, our outreach director. Rugi, why has CAIR taken on the issue of bullying?
That's a good question. And bullying is something that affects all communities. So it's not just the Muslim community, but it's other communities as well. But the reason why CAIR took on this issue is because we wanted to bring anti-Muslim bullying to the forefront. So what we found within the last 2 or 3 years, and Amar can elaborate on that a little bit more, we've seen an increase in bullying cases. So when we saw that, we realized we have to do something about this. So CAIR Philadelphia, along with other CAIR chapters, took it upon themselves and led a nationwide campaign against school bullying to bring our voice to the forefront. So our approach was to look at it three ways. One, to empower youth, to help them to know that they can do something against bullying, also to empower parents, so to help and to teach parents how to advocate for their children, and then also direct advocacy, which Amara will go through further. She will further elaborate on that. But first, I want to take a second and talk about a case that brought national and even international attention to the issue of school bullying. In 2010, there was a 15-year-old girl in Massachusetts who committed suicide because she was bullied for almost over a year by two sets of bullies in her school. And that was a major, major, major case. And sometimes when I talk to parents, they say, well, you know, kids will be the kids. It's just, you know, the kids in the schoolyard. But let me just give you sort of a taste of what she went through. So while she was in school, she got physically abused. She got abused while she was walking in the hallway from classes to classes. And then to make matters worse, when she comes home, she would find derogatory names being called at her on her Facebook page, on her Twitter page, and people would even send nasty messages. So I think I just want to point out that bullying is no longer, okay, kids will be kids, we're playing out on the schoolyard, but it's an issue that follows you when you come home. It's an issue that you can never get away with, from. This 15-year-old teen, she actually felt like there was no way out, and she committed suicide. So this is the situation that we're in right now. And we, as the CAIR chapter, as the nationwide effort, we had this campaign this past year. And I want to say that CAIR Philadelphia was the leader among all CAIR chapters on this. And I think I'm going to pass it on to Amara to talk about our legal work regarding school bullying.
So I just wanted to pick up where Rugi left off. She mentioned the Phoebe Prince case in Massachusetts. If you remember, that was a young woman from Ireland who was bullied, committed suicide, and her tormentors were prosecuted under Massachusetts law. People have probably seen the national press on the Tyler Clementi case out of Rutgers University. So we know that school bullying is getting a lot of press. It's in the media. It's everywhere. There's a documentary. And, you know, of course, we get calls into our office. We had an intake from a young suicidal Muslim girl, actually. Quite sadly, we were able to get her help. But I remember when I first started getting cases in, and I'll be truthful, like, I didn't want to take those cases. So I started calling around town. I said, hey, do you handle school bullying cases? No? Okay. Do you still handle school bullying cases? No? Okay. And that was part of the problem, right? Everyone's talking about it, but who's doing anything about it, right? So I sat down, and early it was small. I created a training for the various CAIR chapters on how to, I call it litigate, but how to litigate school bullying cases under the traditional state anti-bullying statutes, under anti-discrimination laws, and how to file a complaint in the criminal system. And it's actually kind of gone on from there. I approached the something called the Pennsylvania Bar Institute, which is the wing of the State Bar Association, which provides continuing legal education for lawyers. Because my goal was, since no lawyer in Philadelphia other than me that I talked to was handling these, I wanted to train lawyers how to use lawyering skills to deal with this problem. And fortunately, on April 12th of this year, that project is finally coming to fruition. There will be a half-day CLE through the state bar. I'm very proud of it. How many lawyers in the room, by the way? Applause if you're a lawyer. Okay.
Oh,
so
I was so weak.
So if you are a lawyer, go to the PBI website, check out how to litigate a school bullying case. But, I mean, that's a project I'm very proud of. Everyone's talking about it. No one knows what to do about it. And I want to not just ask everyone to call me so I take them on myself, but to train others so that there's a whole community that knows how to address these cases.
So the anti-bullying campaign that CAIR has is an example of a mixture of legal work and a mixture of communications and community outreach. Rugi, can you speak to CAIR's approach on community outreach and media relations?
Right, sure. So I'm going to start with community outreach. So we host different events. In 2012, we hosted two main events, sponsored and co-sponsored. One was dealing with the anti-Muslim bill, House Bill 2029, which was at the Free Library of Philadelphia. And that gave people a platform to talk about the issues surrounding House Bill 2029. We also hosted, co-sponsored another event along with the Nationality Service Center and the American Friends Service Committee that was called Muslims in America, Building Bridges in a Climate of Fear. So that program focused on immigration issues. So those were two major sponsored programs that we had this year. Also, we conduct courses and presentations at universities and houses of worship. So our courses range from Islam 101 to Women in Islam. We also educate the public by advocating social issues, and I think Amara talked a little bit about that. And the most effective way that we educate the public about American Muslims, in my opinion, is through the media. And I guess maybe I'm biased about that. But I think it has a mass appeal that a lot of our work doesn't have. And this year, I was privileged to work on a documentary called Brown Skin Funny Names that talks about the racialization of the American Muslim identity. And that aired on Philadelphia Community Access Channel in January and February. So I'm really proud of that. I produced and directed that documentary on behalf of CAIR Philadelphia. And it went well. The airings went well. Thank you.
And where can the audience see that?
We actually have it online, so you can go to our YouTube channel. We finally put it online. But we're doing screenings, so I guess you can get in touch with CAIR Philadelphia for a screening for Brown Skin Funny Names.
Yes, so we have a YouTube channel. We're cool like that. So I saw the little X sign, which means... Yes. Amara wants to add one thing.
Okay. I just want to... Okay, so after you finish adding...
I did see the X sign, but I think this is an important point. So Ruki talked about our role in the media and how we tell people not only who CAIR is, but who the American Muslim community is. And I think we need to remember there's another way to tell people who we as American Muslims are. One is to tell them. The second is to show them through our actions rather than through our words. And I want to talk about actually a case we worked on a little bit that demonstrated that point. So here in Pennsylvania, there was a gentleman a few months ago named Terry Williams who was sitting on death row. Now, in Philadelphia, the legal community was organizing various aspects of the legal community to support his clemency petition, basically to support the petition to save his life. And, you know, no one actually approached me to ask me to get involved, but I knew about this effort, and as I looked into the matter more closely, I realized that every other religious organization in the Abrahamic tradition had submitted a letter trying to save this man's life. And I looked around, I said, well, I wonder how many Muslim organizations are doing it. Well, none. And in this case, interestingly enough, the victim's widow had actually called upon her own Abrahamic faith in asking Governor Corbett to save the defendant's life. So I wrote a letter that did not cite one fact or article of law, but simply said, "Dear Governor Corbett, I'm calling on the same Abrahamic faith that my Christian and Jewish partners have called upon and wish the victim's widow has called upon, and I'm asking you to do no more or no less than to save this man's life and, in so doing, to save the entire human race." Now, that was important. Thank you. I didn't step out alone. CAIR National had talked in opposition to the death penalty. CAIR Texas had, but locally no Muslims were. Now, we can sit around all day telling people we are peace-loving people. We believe in equality and justice and everything, but it's when you show people what you do and what you believe in, that's what sticks with them. So that's what I want to say.
Yeah, that's a good point, Amar. And I just want to talk about our interview that we had on September 11th. A local radio station personnel called us and said, can you come and speak about the impact of 9/11 on the Muslim community? And I said, sure. But it was interesting because he had some misconceptions about Muslims. He didn't realize that CAIR was staffed with so many females. So he called the office, and the person who picked up the phone was Lena. Lena, can you raise your hand? We do that every year. Our office manager, and he was shocked that he called a Muslim organization and a female picked up the phone. Now, after she transferred the call to me, I was talking to him, which is, I happen to be a female, and I told him that I would bring my colleague with me, who is a female, and he was shocked. He was just, and this is someone who is relatively educated and, you know, I guess, into the community. But he has this idea that, you know, Muslims don't prefer women to be in leadership positions or running organizations. So that was a way that we showed this radio personnel that that's not the case. We always talk about how women are empowered in Islam, and Muslim women are empowered. But as you said, we actually showed him, you know, by action. Thank you.
That's it. All right. Just wanted to thank everybody for listening during our little conversation on stage. Please visit our website at pa.care.com. We have a lot of informational publications. Specifically, I'll just give an example. We have a PDF on Know Your Rights. If somebody in the community is contacted by law enforcement, what are your initial steps? We also have numerous other publications regarding bullying, as Ruki and Amara mentioned. So please do visit our website. Thank you again.
Thank you very much. Our next speaker is a man who needs no introduction, but I'll still give him an introduction, inshallah. He's the Imam of Masjid al-Taqwa in Brooklyn, New York. He's the Amir of Muslim Alliance in North America. Now I'm getting nervous because he has such an impression on me, mashallah. He's actually served on the National Board of CAIR. And, you know, I usually give nice introductions, but he's, mashallah, a person I've met so many times and actually got a chance to speak to, and he doesn't even have an ego because he wants me to finish his introduction right now. I have a feeling he's standing right next to me. Here he is. It's Imam Siraj Wahhaj. He's a personal friend of mine and a real, real true inspiration. Please put your hands together for Imam Siraj Wahhaj. Jazakallah khair.
As-salamu alaykum. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wahdahu la sharika lah. Wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan abduhu wa rasul amma ba'd. Brothers and sisters, I want to say in a few moments why we should support CAIR. My job tonight is to ask you for money. As if you're surprised. But I want to do it quickly. Wednesday night, I'm sitting in my office, and a delegation of brothers from Bangladesh came into my office telling me about what's going on in Bangladesh, how people are being killed. It was so horrible. I was in my office crying. The irony is that Bangladesh, a country of 160 million people, 90% of them Muslim. And they're coming to an African-American imam for help. Found out that night that CAIR already is helping and doing their work to alleviate the suffering of the people in Bangladesh. Why should we give tonight $170,000 to CAIR? Have you ever really read the Constitution of the United States of America? Have you really studied it? It is a magnificent document. What makes it so special? For me, there are three things I don't question. Meaning I accept. I'm not smart enough to argue against. Number one, it's Allah, the Lord of the world's God. Number two, the Prophet, peace and blessing be upon him, said, Al-Anbiya'u alatun ikhwatun li'alatin umma'atum shatta wad-dinuhum wahid. Prophets are brothers, their mothers are different, but their religion is one. So I don't argue with whatever Jesus say, I believe it. Whatever Moses say, I believe it. Whatever Abraham say, I believe it. Whatever Muhammad, peace and blessing be upon all of them, say, whatever they say, I believe it. I don't have no arguments against any of the prophets. Number three, Allah revealed in Quran وأنزل التوراة والإنجيل. And we sent down the Torah and we sent down the gospel. So that gospel that was revealed to Jesus, I believe it, I accept it, I ain't got no argument with it. That revelation that was sent down to Moses, we believe in it, we accept it, we ain't got no argument with it. The Constitution never declared, or the authors of the Constitution never declared, that this is a divine decree from God. It is an argument, it is a manuscript from man. And the founding fathers were wise enough to put a provision in the Constitution that it can be changed and altered. So in the history of man, in the history of America, we have 27 amendments to the Constitution of the United States of America. Did you know that since 1789, there have been over 100,000 constitutional amendments that were introduced to Congress? Why is care important? Because something that my mother always told me, she said, son, people are people. What does that mean? That means that we have to protect this document, the Constitution of the United States of America. We must protect it as it protects us, because people are people. And the same way we can change it for good, we can change it for evil. So we need people that are wide awake and understand that. Why should we give $170,000 tonight to care? I want to compliment you tonight. All of the believers, you've done good. I believe that everyone here tonight are generous, that you have given over and over again. If you're Muslim, you've given to your masjids, you've given to your schools, you've given to Islamic Relief. I've seen some of you that I've seen over the years. You come over and over again, you give to care, you've given in the past to care, and yet tonight we come and we ask you to give again. So I congratulate you who have reached the level of being generous and a believer, but tonight I have one more challenge for you. And believe me, I'm speaking literally for minutes. In a few minutes, I'll be off this stage and I'll be sitting here waiting for our keynote speaker. Just minutes. And the organizers made me make sure I understood I only had minutes. I love graduations. Imam, I cry at every graduation. Elementary school, junior high school, college. I'm at a college graduation, and the MC is about to introduce the graduates. And they say, so-and-so, graduating cum laude, with distinction. And then they turn around and they introduced another graduate, so-and-so, magna cum laude, with great distinction. And then, behold, they bring forth another graduate, summa cum laude, with the highest of distinction. I don't want to be ordinary anymore. So many of us, we spend our lives ordinary, average, going to an average school, getting average grades, get an average job with an average position on the job, getting an average husband. That's not any of you tonight. I want to graduate. I want to be on the same level. So tonight I'm asking you not to be on the same level. I mentioned the figure, how many constitutional amendments introduced to Congress. What number did I say? 10,000. Did I say 100,000? Then it's probably 100,000. I got a wake-up call recently. You know, every once in a while when you do some Islamic work, you imam over masjid, you a speaker, you kind of think you did something. Made some donations, and you say, I'm pretty good. I've donated, and I've spoken at the masjid, I've given sermons there, and I've given lectures, traveled all over the world. And you start feeling pretty good about yourself. That's okay. But I got a wake-up call recently. I want you to do me a favor. Right now, Muslims, I want you to think about the companions of the Messenger of Allah, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And I want you to put on your list right now, don't write it down, but put it in your mind, three companions. Write them down now in your mind. One, two, three. You got them? How many of you included in your list Abu Bakr? Raise your hand. Raise them up high. Look around. Okay, good. How many of you included Umar in your list? Raise your hand. Look around. I want you to look around. Look around. Raise them up high. Raise them high. Look around. Now, the Prophet had over 100,000 companions. How did I know that you would include those two in your list? I must be pretty smart. A wake-up call. Would you say Umar radiallahu anhu had impeccable credentials? Would you? And if we would list the impeccable credentials of Umar, we would say, you know what? He participated in every battle. The battle of Badr, the battle of Uhud, and so forth and so on. You would say that he was the second Khalifa. You would probably mention that the Prophet, peace and blessing be upon him, said that I went to Jannah, I saw myself in paradise, and I saw a palace, and I asked the question, who does this palace belong to? And it was said, Umar. Remember this hadith? And Umar and the Prophet, peace and blessing be upon him, said, I was about to go into the palace until I remembered the ghayra of Umar, the dignity of Umar, and I didn't go in. And then the Prophet told Umar of that, peace and blessing be upon him, and Umar cried and said, how dare I put my ghayra in front of you, O Messenger of Allah? Would you say that these are impeccable credentials? Is there anyone here that have such credentials? Is one of you have that? And believe me, I can put a whole long list of credentials, impeccable credentials of Umar. Yet, gave me a wake-up call. You know what happened? For 10 years, Umar had an obsession with finding a man. So therefore, every time a delegation from Yemen came, he said, Afikum Uwais ibn Amir? Afikum Uwais ibn Amir? Afikum Uwais ibn Amir? Is there a man among you named Uwais ibn Amir? For 10 years, in obsession, he wanted to find this man. And every time a delegation from Yemen came, he asked the same question until finally a man said, yes, I am. He said, are you from the tribe of Murad and the branch of Quran? He said, yes, because Umar wanted to make sure that this is the right man. He's obsessed with it. He said, yes. He said, did you used to have leprosy and it was cured except the size of a dirham? He said, yes. He said, do you have a mother that's alive? He said, yes. He found this man. Here's the payoff. Umar said to Uwais, he said, the Prophet, peace and blessing be upon him, told me that there will be a delegation from Yemen, and there will be among them a man named Uwais ibn Amir from the tribe of Murad in the branch of Quran, and he would have had leprosy, and it was cured except the size of a dirham. And he had a mother that he was obedient to. If you find him, Umar, if you're able to, ask him to pray to Allah for your forgiveness. What? What? Did you hear what I just said? All of these impeccable credentials, Ashura Mubashura, one of the companions, the 10 companions that were paradised by the Prophet, peace and blessing be upon him, and for 10 years, he's looking for this one man just to make supplication for him. Tonight, I'm asking you, if Umar did that when he had it made, what about us?
Inshallah. If you cannot, if no one does pick it up, that brings me to my second announcement. There will be a silent auction for a very good cause, me. And I'm just joking. No, your watch is at our table, table five, inshallah. So up next, we're going to have giving some awards out. And we have awards? Yes, we do. So our first award is going to be for the Youth Award. Young Muslim Americans can express their opinions and challenges every day with the same notions and as adults. And that fact has driven a very special young brother named Abdul Malik, who's 17, found his own website. And the website's called, if you haven't seen it, make sure you go check it out. It's called truthfromateen.com. He developed this website when he was only 14 years old to promote the voice of an important demographic often overlooked. In 2010, the blog was one to get to contact of Florida pastor Terry Jones. And for those who are not familiar with him, he was a guy who's doing the whole burn the Quran thing and that whole controversy. He was one of the first people to get his attention. And he also got the attention of the mayor of Gainesville, Florida, local churches, mosques, and even the Vatican. Through his website, spoken word poetry, and his position at the student body present at a high school, he's made a real positive difference, and we would like to recognize him tonight. Please join me with recognizing Abdul Malik for the Youth Award.
Assalamu alaikum, brothers and sisters. As I stepped onto the stage and I saw this beautiful crowd, only one word came to my mind, and that word was Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah. I started my website, truthfromateen.com, when I was 14 years old, and never in my wildest dreams would I imagine standing here in front of you all today. First and foremost, I'd like to thank the organization, CAIR, for all they've done for me and for the Muslims in our region. I'd especially like to thank Brother Moeen Khawaja, who couldn't be here today, and Sister Rugi Athukanta for this incredible honor. You can give her a round of applause for them. Second, I'd like to thank my family, my sisters, my uncle and aunt who are in the audience, and my parents, my mother and father. For without their love and support, I wouldn't even be who I am today. And last, and certainly the most, I thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for his infinite mercy, for his grace, and for his forgiveness. Thank you. Jazakallah khair. Assalamu alaikum.
Our next award is the Community Service Award. Khaled bin Brown is a tireless worker in the community and is well known for his well establishing his special foundation called the Islamic Heritage Foundation. It's a nonprofit organization that promotes education and leadership development for ages 13 to 25 and motivates students to study the Quran. He has been doing this, and he's the executive director, and he's been doing this for 20 years. His role has supervised volunteers, coordinating numerous endeavors, including youth academic awards, contests, and publications of his newspaper, the Blackstone newspaper. Please put your hands together and let us recognize Khaled bin Brown for the Community Service Award.
Alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salamu ala khayru muslimin, Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajmi'in. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wahdahu la sharika lah, wa ashhadu anna Muhammadin abduhu wa rasuluh. All praises be to Allah. We ask peace and blessing be on the one best amongst the prophets, Muhammad bin Abdullah, as well as his family and his companions. I bear witness there's nothing worth worship but Allah, and I bear witness that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam is a slave servant, the Qattama an-Nabiyin, the seal of the Prophets, wa akhir rasul, his last messenger. Bye-bye. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I have my daughter up here, Khadija. Give me a little more support here. I have a lot to say, but because of time constraints, I'm going to make myself brief as I possibly can. I'm grateful and humble to be standing in front of you this evening. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. First and foremost, I'd like to thank CAIR for this beautiful award and for the beautiful relationship that we established through the years. And I pray that each and every year we will become closer and closer. I'd like to congratulate the awardees, Brother Adel Malik, Imam Adualin, and I also want to congratulate Masjid Allah for purchasing their new building, Alhamdulillah. I also want to give a shout out to my people who came from Maryland, Virginia, and even all the way from Saudi Arabia. Alhamdulillah. I want to take this opportunity to thank my wife, Nabia Parker. She's a little shy. She told me not to mention her name. For
for all the help that she's done. She's been with me through thick and thin, and I can't be grateful to Allah enough for a wonderful, beautiful wife he's blessed me with. Alhamdulillah, Rabbi Alameen. And I want to thank all the ones who's been involved with the Islamic Heritage Foundation for 20 years. And I want to ask everyone here to help us in our endeavor in building communities, strengthening families, and empowering our youth, inshallah. So can I get your support? It's been a long, hard, arduous life, and they give me the X. And so I'm gonna try to cut it short. There's some other points I wanted to say, but I have to say, I had many teachers. My mother, my father, Frankie Francis Brown, they taught me well. And I will never be grateful enough for all the life lessons they taught me. So I had to say that. In closing, I'd like to say, everybody here is a star, no matter who you are. And the more grateful you are, the brighter your light will shine. Be grateful. I want to ask everyone to remember Naila, little Naila and Imam Asim and their family. Our children are calling out for help. I'm winding down. The children are calling out for help, and I need you to help me to help our children. Jazakallah khairan. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Congratulations, Jazakallah khair. And next, our next award is a Lifetime Achievement Award. Imam Muhammad Abdul Alim has been involved with ongoing Islamic projects since he first became Muslim accepting Islam back in 1968. In this year, he also began the development of a 5-volume concordance of the Holy Quran. The project has been molded his Islamic character and provided a framework for his later work as an imam, a religious leader. He served as a resident imam from 1982 to 2001, and he currently serves as a guest speaker at many Islamic centers. He has done many, many amazing things, but one of the things that really, really stands out is that he's been author of so many major books, and those books include Vocabulary of the Holy Quran, Concordance of the Holy Quran, Volumes 1 through 5, and The Excellence of Worship and Islamic Lectures, Volume 1. Please join me in recognizing Imam Muhammad Abdul Alim for the Lifetime Achievement Award.
Assalamu alaikum. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa Allah wa ahdu la sharika lah. Wa ashhadu anna Muhammad Abdul Rasulullah. I would like to give praise and thanks to Allah. Highly glorified be He. I want to thank the CAIR organization for giving me this award. And I want to in my time that I have, I know I got about 2 minutes. How many minutes do I have? About 2 minutes. I only need two minutes. We're in the time of technology, so I'm gonna make this easy. As I listen to my brother Siraj, who I've known for many, many years. In fact, back when we first made the transition to al-Islam and followed the Sunnah Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, I was one of the ones responsible for helping them learn the Quran and learn the Arabic language. So always so good when I see him to see how well he has grown in his knowledge of the Quran. And I was also very honored to see my brother, Khalilullah. I remember we were discussing the idea of having not only just an essay contest. I said, brother, we need to have our people, our students, learn the Quran, have them begin to recite. I said, because in my travels, I've seen Muslims devote themselves to the Quran. And any community that devotes themselves to the Quran and time will produce ulema, will produce fuqaha, will produce hafiz. And it will get the philosophical insight as to how to establish al-Islam in the environment that they're in. I say oftentimes with us as Muslims, we struggle with that because we don't know how to do what this says up here. Look at the foundation. Embrace our faith. When you can find the philosophical basis for the Constitution in your Quran, you have no dichotomy. When you can find the language of the Quran in the Constitution, you have no dichotomy, no conflict in character. So we at Masjid Allah have made it our point. On an annual basis, we have our Jummah along with the Ikpik down at Independence Mall. Because in America...
I've been told that so far tonight we have raised $93,000. Alhamdulillah. Although it's a great accomplishment, it's so far away from our original goal of $175,000. You know, as many of us see the great accomplishments of CAIR, you read in the newspaper, you see on the internet. If you want the program, if you want this organization to keep progressing, we have to continue to try to help CAIR, and the best way to help it is with finances. My next speaker is our keynote speaker for tonight. And you already have an introduction to her, just a brief introduction, and that's watching her film at the beginning of our event. She's a creator of that series, Little Mosque on the Prairie. That series is now shown in 60 countries, and it eventually became the highest rated sitcom, not the Muslim sitcom, overall sitcom on the CBC Canadian Broadcasting Channel. Not only has she worked on that project, but she's worked on many other projects, and she's worked on scripts and shorts for CBS, NBC, Fox, ABC, pretty much name it the channel, she's probably done something for it. So, mashallah, she's very, very talented, and she's a professional, and it's amazing work. Without any further introduction, I would like you to please put your hands together for our keynote speaker, Zarqa Nawaz, please. Here she comes.
Assalamu alaikum. Can everyone hear me? Even at the back? Okay, I'd like to thank the organizers for being exceedingly patient with me. Osama invited me 6 months ago, and I'm so terrible at returning emails and the constant reminders, and please send us your speech, and are you actually going to make it? The poor man, there was a huge snowstorm in Canada. For those of you who don't know, Little Mosque on the Prairie was named because I live on the prairie. I live above Montana, you know, above North Dakota in the Midwest. So around this time, we have, you know, this change of weather causes, you know, bad snowstorms. So to get to Philadelphia from Saskatchewan, you have to fly from Regina to Toronto and then catch a connecting from Toronto to Philadelphia. And there was only like an hour, you know, difference between the two flights. So when you had to be tight, we had to arrive on time. And we could tell that, you know, that morning my husband dropped me off at the airport and it was, you know, the flurries and the snow and I was all swirling. And, you know, the pilot said, you know, we have to spray down the wings. I don't know if you do that here where you put, what is it called? De-icing fluid. And it's like this, it's always some neon green or I don't know why they do that pink or, so, you know, it looks like a giant popsicle. Like you look like you're flying on a popsicle. So they sprayed down the wings and, you know, it took like a good extra half hour. And then, you know, it's like, okay, inshallah, we'll make it. And then, you know, we headed straight down the runway. And then suddenly the pilot said, you know, I feel the left wing has failed. It's de-icing. I don't know how. What that means. He goes, let's do it one more time. And so he turned the plane around to the, you know, the beginning of the thing. And I knew that was it. I wasn't going to make my connecting flight. And I couldn't even tell Osama that I wasn't going to make it because, you know, how they take away your phones and if you text, they'll get all crazy. And so, it, you know, an hour in this plane, just de-icing. And then And I was getting so angry. And you should never get angry when you're on a plane because you don't know what the next plane, what could happen to you. Right? You know, I just felt like I was on a PIA plane and the pilot is saying, you know, they didn't load on my special samosa. Let's turn around and reload the samosa. It's like de-icing the plane. It was important. Anyway, I missed the connecting flight. And luckily, when it's their fault, they put you on the next flight. But that was like 5 hours later. By the time we landed, it was like midnight. And, you know, poor Osama and his wife, they were going to take me to dinner. But luckily, the two of them had a nice romantic dinner on their own. So it was good. It was a blessing in disguise. I had a very unromantic dinner in the lounge of the Toronto airport. So alhamdulillah, this is my first time in Philadelphia. And I'm so honored to have been invited. And so what I wanted to talk today was about the power of story and how, and you know, when I was writing my speech, I was thinking about the Quran, and you know, Brother Siraj would know this, like how much of the Quran is actually based on story, how powerful this is, that we are taught our faith, we are taught our religion through the stories of the prophets, and how much difference that makes, you know, to read the story of Prophet Musa or Prophet Suleiman or, you know, Prophet Noah, peace be upon them all, and how that is the mode that Allah has chosen to reach us as human beings, because it's the most relatable way that human beings meet each other and relate to each other. And then I thought about, you know, my background and how I came to make this television series, and it was this desperate need to tell our story, the story of Muslims in North America. And but you know, to go back to my personal story of how I got to making this show, I have to talk about my parents. They, like most, we're from Pakistan. I grew up in Canada, but my parents are Punjabi from Faisalabad, and so they came to this country to want a better life for their kids, and which always means one profession, right? So I was. What's the word? Not blackmailed. Brainwashed? Yes, brainwashed to become a doctor. From the day I could understand what that word meant, it was, this is what you will be. So I absorbed it completely and wholly, and I took all the science courses and math courses and, you know, all the things that I, you know, now I look back, I realize I didn't actually have the talent for, but forced myself to do it because I didn't want to disappoint my parents. And it was when I reached university that I realized that no matter how hard I tried, I just didn't have that passion that it took to do this. But I had to finish the degree because I had started and it had been so difficult. So I did the 4-year science degree, and then I sort of sat there and I went, now what? Because I, you know, I had applied to medical school maybe once or twice and had not gotten in. And it sort of was this horrible, horrible feeling in your heart because your entire life has been built up to this one goal only, and then you don't make that goal. And I remember sitting there thinking, oh, I'm going to spend the rest of my life making widgets in some factory. And then my mom was like, no, I have a better plan. We'll get you married. Because my mom was never all that keen on the doctor plan. You know, like most mothers, they want to see their daughters settled. And as far as she was concerned, I was getting older and older and very stale on the marriage market. And she just wanted to like close the deal as fast as she could. And my father was so depressed, he was, you know, inconsolable. So he wasn't paying attention to me. So Ami just jumped and said, oh, you know, let's get her married. This is it. She saw this opportunity. And the next thing I knew, there were all these... A lot of PhD candidates from Pakistan are studying in the U.S. A lot, I must say. And the one thing that they're missing is a green card. And the way they can get a green card, it turns out, is through marriage. And so all of a sudden, there are all these men coming and having dinner with our family. And they're like, if you marry me, I can make you my housewife in Karachi. And I was like, you know, it's great. It's really great and everything. But I just don't know if I'm ready to do that yet. And to my my mother's great consternation, I applied to journalism school because my best friend was always talking about being a journalist. And I thought that was one of those sexy, forbidden careers that Muslims don't go into, right? We pick the holy trinity of medicine, engineering, law. And so journalism was just like, you know, out there in this, world that we never touch. And so I was desperate. So, and it was the only deadline that hadn't passed after my medical school application had failed. So I quickly applied, you know, had no experience, no portfolio, like nothing, right? Because I had never even thought about this as a plan B. But I had to stop this endless parade of men. So I applied, and I actually got an interview. And in retrospect, the reason that they interviewed me was because I was the only one who had applied, not with no experience, but who had a science degree. And they had never had someone do that before. They, you know, usually if you want to be a journalist, you get your BA in arts or English. And here I was with not a single English course to my name, science all the way. And they're like, why would you do this? Like, why do you want to be a journalist? And I was so lucky because a man interviewed me. And just before I walked in, I was flipping through, you know, women's magazines in the waiting area, and there was some article about Norplant. I don't know if you guys remember, but back then it was this new revolutionary birth control method where they would put in a woman's arm, and for 5 years she, you know, it would work as a birth control, so you wouldn't have to take the pill. And so when he goes, well, why do you want to be a journalist? And I, have you ever heard about Norplant? And of course he hadn't, right? And I said, well, if you let me in, I will write articles about this incredibly revolutionary device, you know, birth control, no one's ever heard of, which was in every single woman's magazine, and, you know, 5 feet away from him, but he was a man and he didn't know. And I said, you should let me in because how else will you ever learn? And he's like, yes, you are right. We need more people with a science background. We should let you in. I know it's terrible that I lie to Stuffler, I don't ever do this, but he let me in. Without, you know, and I never should have been let in because I had no portfolio, no experience. And people had been, you know, trying to be journalists their whole life. Like I had been trying to be a doctor who had worked for their student newspaper and had portfolios this big. Anyways, alhamdulillah, he let me in. And there I blossomed as a journalist. You know, it was the skill that I had but never knew I had because I was so busy trying to figure out why, you know, cubes, calculating the mass of rotating cubes in the physics class. I don't even know why we'd need to know that, right? But anyway... I did very well in journalism school, and then I got an internship with CBC Television. And it was there that the Gulf War had broken out, and they didn't have any, back then, no Muslims had gone into journalism, and they needed me to help them understand the Muslim community, the numbers, where the demographics were, who the imams were, where the mosques were. So I, you know, I helped them understand the community. And then I got an internship with CBC Radio. With, you probably don't know him, the late Peter Zosky. No, probably not. Is a famous Canadian radio broadcaster, and so he, you know, he would do these incredible one-hour radio shows, and I would one of the researchers where I would go and I would, you know, phone people, get questions for him, and write up their backgrounds, biography, and hand it to him, and he would do this like incredible magic on the radio. And then I sort of felt sort of this need. I loved journalism, but there was something missing. There was sort of this creative itch that I had that I couldn't, you know, reach with this radio show. And I asked someone, well, how do you become a filmmaker? And they said, there's many ways in, but why don't you take a course at the Ontario College of Art and you can make a film? So I took this course in the summer. It was 3 weeks. And at that time, the Oklahoma bombing had happened. Do you guys remember that Timothy McVeigh was arrested after Muslims were first accused of that terrorism attack? And there are all these pictures in the newspapers of potential Muslim suspects. And in the end, it turned out to be Timothy McVeigh. So that sort of sparked something in me. And I created a short comedy called Barbecue Muslims, where two Muslim brothers are sleeping one night, and the barbecue blows up in the backyard, and they're accused of being Middle Eastern terrorists. And they're like, but we haven't even been to the Middle East. And they're like, it doesn't matter, you fit the profile. So it was a comedy about, you know, Muslims getting confused with terrorism. This was like 1994. When did the Oklahoma bombing happen? 95, I think. Anyway, I made it, I submitted it to the Toronto International Film Festival and promptly forgot about it, right? Because by that time I was married, I had a baby, and I was, you know, I was living in Saskatchewan. And then I get this phone call from the Toronto International Film Festival going, you know, you forgot to put your phone number on the application form. We had a hard time tracking you down. Luckily, they found another person with my last name who happened to be my brother, and he told them where I lived, and they found me in Saskatchewan. And it said, listen, you made a student film using your parents' house and your next door neighbors who aren't actors. And there are going to be a lot of angry people whose perfectly technical, perfect films got rejected for yours. But you made a comedy about Muslims and terrorism, and no one's ever done this before. And we've never seen anything like this until, you know, in the film world. And we just feel like you should be presenting this film. And so that was how I broke into to the world of film. Because that was a very prestigious film festival to be accepted in. And in Canada, if you have what you call a calling card film, you can then apply for grants for your next film. And so I raised, I think, through the Canadian system about $30,000, and this time, you know, wrote a script called Death Threat. And that was the time when, you know, Salman Rushdie and Taslima Nasreen and all these writers were getting fatwas of death. I just wrote a really funny comedy about Yasmin Siddiqui, who is a writer who wrote a really schlocky romantic novel and can't get anyone to pay attention to her. So she decides to upset someone in the Muslim community until they're willing to sentence her to death so that she can use that death threat to propel her career, which doesn't exist. And so she goes around upsetting everyone in her community and complaining about them and writing terrible articles in the newspaper. And meanwhile, the community's like, just what do you want? We'll do anything. Just, you know, just tell us what you want. We'll fix it. And she's realizing that they're trying to appease her and they're not sentencing her to death. So she decides to take a shortcut to her fatwa of death and goes to visit the leader of the Hamas, who is having a lecture only for men. And she writes out her own death threat and, you know, decides on a $3 million bounty with a signature line, you know, goes to his lecture. Only the trouble is she had misread the poster. He wasn't the leader of the Hamas. He was a cooking instructor for hummus. And the class was only for men because they were too embarrassed to learn to cook in front of their wives. But she doesn't care. She gets him to sign it anyway. And he gets arrested for, hummus instructor sentence woman to death. The media goes crazy. No one really asks too many questions. And it's sort of a comedy. It was a 20-minute comedy called Death Threat. And that also made it to the Toronto International Film Festival. So it was through this story-making that I realized I had these skills for comedy and that I could take these stereotypes of Muslims and contemporary issues and fuse them together and make people laugh at subjects that they had never seen on television before. And that's when the National Film Board of Canada approached me to do a documentary. And at that time in our mosque, you know, we had this lovely space in Regina, Saskatchewan, and the women prayed behind the men, and it was, you know, very egalitarian. And then I think we got an imam from India or Saudi Arabia, I can't remember. Someone came and felt that the women had too much access to the khatib and the prayer and that they should be separated. And next thing we knew, there was like this huge curtain that had been put up and we couldn't see anymore. And, you know, eventually we were put behind a glass wall. And then, you know, it caused a lot of conflict in our community. A lot of the women in the second generation stopped going to the mosque and they felt they were no longer welcome. So I made a documentary called Me in the Mosque. I traveled across North America and interviewed men and women and to find out what was happening to our community, what this sort of encroaching conservatism was kind of destroying the fabric of our community because women were feeling less and less welcome. Because what was happening was, you know, tradition was being mistaken for theology. Like, people really believed that women during the time of the Prophet didn't have access to the khatib, that they didn't actually, you know, that they believed that these veils or rooms or curtains existed, which they didn't. So I made a documentary sort of to show Muslims that, you know, in fact, we had very egalitarian spaces during that time. And I realized that a lot of this stuff was coming from overseas, that was cultural baggage, and it was infecting our community. And that's when the idea came to me, what if the imam was born and raised here in North America and had an affinity for egalitarian values of Islam that were, you know, natural and organic from this community? Would it change the dynamic of a Muslim community? And that's where the idea of Little Mosque in the Prairie came from. So Amar, who you saw, was a lawyer who had his training overseas, but he wants to be an imam that's going to be fair to young people, to teenagers, to women, and how that would change the dynamic in the community. And so I pitched this to CBC Television. And for those of you who don't know, CBC Television in Canada is like PBS in the United States. It's publicly funded. So there's always this debate in Canada, why should we give them taxpayers' dollars? They never make really, you know, inventive programming. Your ratings are so low. So when this show aired, just before the show aired, we got incredible media exposure from all over the world, particularly from the US, the New York Times and CNN. I was interviewed by Glenn Beck. It was incredible. And, you know, back now that I look back, it was because they were expecting violence and anger from the Muslim community because we had come on the tail ends of the Danish cartoon controversy. So people thought Muslims couldn't take comedy, couldn't take humor, and would be very angry with this show because it was the first Muslim sitcom in North America. And we didn't even start with, you know, a living room, you know, like the Cosby Show, where it's like a living room in a family and, you know, husband, wife. It was a comedy about an imam in a mosque, which was set in a church, and it was about faith. And they didn't think Muslims could handle it. So we got this incredible amount of publicity, which was good because in Canada, the reason you haven't heard of Canadian shows is because we can't compete with the millions and millions of ad dollars that American has to promote their shows, like, you know, and Desperate Housewives and all these shows like House. But suddenly we got what we couldn't afford, which was all this media attention. So by the time we aired, Canadians had heard of the show, because normally Canadians don't even hear of our own shows. And so we broke records for our pilot, the one that you watched. I mean, CBC hadn't had those numbers since Anne of Green Gables. I don't know if you've heard of that show, which aired 20 years previous to Little Mosque. So it took 20 years and a show about Muslims in the middle of, in a mosque in the middle of nowhere, to revive the fortunes of the CBC, which I thought was, you know, quite ironic. We went on to, you know, to incredible ratings. They renewed us. We just finished airing the sixth season in the 91st episode last April. It's available in the U.S. through Hulu. People keep asking me, how can they get it? Fox did try to, well, they didn't try. They bought the rights to make it, but decided not to. And I always wondered why. I don't know. I mean, people always ask me, do I think a show like this could exist in the United States? It's a hard question. It wasn't until the first test case I can think of, which was TLC's show All American Muslim, aired, I think, a year ago. And one man created the Family Florida Association. And it wasn't, he was the creator and sole person who ran it. I was just reading about this in Wikipedia. And so when All American Muslim aired, which was a reality show about Muslims living in Dearborn, he gave out a press release saying that this show, because it showed Muslims as normal people, they were whitewashing Americans to the true threat of Islam. So that was his argument. And so about 65 advertisers pulled out of that show, McDonald's, Amazon, but Lowe's was the only one who made the mistake of saying that they had pulled out because of this concern of this organization. And so, you know, people boycotted Lowe's, and there was petitions and all this anger. And in the end, TLC canceled All American Muslim after a year, citing low ratings. But I mean, I think, then I called our advertising department at CBC and said, did we ever have something similar happen in Canada? And she said, no, the opposite happened. Our demographic was really highly educated and made a lot of money. So we had luxury brands trying to advertise on the show. So we had lots of banks and insurance companies, and we always had problems with product placement. We were always trying to get us to put their product on the show because they realized that our demographic, the viewers, were so, you know, highly educated and made so much money. And so, in fact, we had the opposite problem happening in Canada. So I guess that's the difference between the two countries in terms of Islamophobia and the different attitudes towards Islam and Muslims. Not that things are great in Canada. We, you know, we do have the lowest rating in terms of, you know, people liking us, for sure. That's not, but I feel there is a difference between the two countries. That 9/11 happened here, and it has caused a lot of distrust and anger, and that the right-wing contingent is much more strong in the United States. So what I would encourage everyone to do is, we need more storytellers. There's just nothing, you know, there's no way to around that. Nobody else is going to tell our story the way we will tell it. Otherwise, you get Argo, you get Homeland, you get Sleeper Cell, you know, I don't know how many other shows like that exist. I mean, the only, you know, Muslim that's allowed on American television screens is the terrorist, and that's the only image that we see. In order to turn that around, we need more storytellers that will tell our story, you know, from our vision. And that means we have to encourage our young people who have the skills to go into writing, you know, anything from television writing to film writing to playwrights, to become journalists, to become editorialists, to become newscasters, to become, you know, on-camera personalities. There's simply no way to turn that tide around until we tell our own stories, because nobody else is going to do that for us. And, you know, when I look at stories about culture and faith that have resonated in the American fabric, I think of, say, Fiddler on the Roof. Have you heard of that play? Fiddler on the Roof, I think started on Broadway in the 1950s, and it was about a Jewish man who lived in Russia in 1905 and had five daughters, and it was about his struggle with his five daughters and his culture and his traditions. It was the most successful Broadway play, I think, in recent history. It ran for 10 years straight until Greece finally usurped it. And I think about that show as this incredibly wonderful, rich tapestry, you know, of Jewish tradition and life that penetrated all of, you know, in America. I mean, you know, how many of us have had children who've been in a play about Fiddler on the Roof? It's incredible. And I always, you know, I try to go to New York and catch the latest Broadway plays because they sort of give you a snapshot of what's happening in the American cultural world. And I just went to New York last year and I saw The Book of Mormon. Have you guys seen The Book of Mormon? Have you heard of South Park? Yeah. Two guys, Matt Stone and Trey Parker, they're the creators of South Park. And they decided, they had a friend who was Mormon. I think that's the backstory. And they wrote this hilarious comedy, it's not for everyone, about two Mormon missionaries who go to Uganda and try to convert the Ugandans to become Mormons. And it's this hysterical look at the Mormon faith. And it's brilliant, and it's funny, and it's considered the most popular Broadway musical in New York today. And, you know, if I was a member of the Mormon Church, I would kind of wonder about this play. And in fact, the Mormon Church released a press release when it came out, and they said, we invite you to learn more about our faith. Instead of becoming angry or upset about this play, which sometimes was very mocking to them, they used it as a way in to their faith and their community. And the two creators of this play said, we always had faith in this, you know, in this faith, in this religion. We knew that they wouldn't, you know, turn against us. And that's the message that I have for the Muslim community, is that, you know, there's a place for stories about religion and faith and culture, and it's waiting for us to tell them. And we have to be the ones who tell them, because nobody else is going to be telling those stories. They're going to be telling the stories like, you know, Ben Affleck told about Argo. And if we want change, then we have to be that change, because nobody else will be doing that for us. Thank you. Assalamu alaikum.